Hi everyone, I'm Doug Hurley from Synapse Energy Economics. The first question I have is, barring being able to stand in the middle of the room and doing theater in the round, where should I put myself? Is here okay? I feel a bit bad for the folks here having to crane their necks, but you have the slides in front of you, so you can flip through them in front of you if you don't want to turn and
Well, Doug,
our generation grew up playing Twister. We're good.
Okay. Okay. That works for me. I want to make sure that's okay. I've been working with the Cape Light Compact on analyzing their energy efficiency data and assisting them with their interactions with the wholesale markets through the energy efficiency programs for about 6 years now. For a little over 8 years, I've been involved with the electricity grid in New England and all the rules of the wholesale markets. So that 8 years of knowledge, I've distilled much of it down today into this group of slides. And the intent of today's slides is to walk you through the process that Synapse recently undertook to calculate the avoided costs for energy efficiency programs and how we then applied those same calculations to the installation of solar photovoltaic systems situated behind the meter here on the Cape, and to try and demonstrate that there are financial benefits not just to the owners of those systems, but to all ratepayers. So that's the purpose of it, and I'll walk through. Ever since I moved back to the East Coast, I got used to talking fast, so feel free to interrupt me and stop me along the way. I'm used to questions as we go along. You won't knock me off my groove, if you will. Just a quick slide you have in your presentation there about who Synapse Energy Economics is. We just celebrated our 15th anniversary just a couple of months ago. It was a great party. I'm sorry you missed it. The avoided energy supply costs study is something that's undertaken every 2 years by the efficiency program administrators and other sponsoring parties. And you've got all of the logos there and the list of the names of the other folks as well who are intricately involved in this study. We do most of the work, but we interact with the study group on a constant basis as we develop interim deliverables, and we check with them to make sure everything we've done so far meets their needs and as we go through the process. So they're very intricately involved. I want to make sure people know it's not a process where we go away for 3 months and come back and just and hand them a product. The purpose of this avoided cost study is that the energy efficiency, both electric and gas, program administrators throughout all of New England, all six New England states, they need something that they can take to their regulatory body in their state, whether it's the DPU here in Mass or whichever state, and demonstrate to them that if we were to go and do these energy efficiency programs that we proposed, here are the benefits that would come out of doing those programs. So when you're trying to do a cost-benefit analysis, you've got costs on one side, someone needs to figure out what the benefits are. And that's the purpose of the avoided energy supply cost study. Today I'm going to focus entirely on electricity, not so much on natural gas, but the study does address the avoided natural gas costs as well. And there are a number of different components to it. Some of them are relatively easy to figure out in your head. Some of them are a bit more complicated. So I'm going to spend more time on the complicated ones, of course. But the purpose of it is just that, is to figure out what are the benefits from doing energy efficiency programs. And one of the key caveats to know throughout all the rest of the slides that we go through is the way we do this study is we're doing this in 2011. We assume for the purpose of the study that no more energy efficiency programs will take place, 2012 and forward. Because that's the only way we can calculate what the cost of electricity would have been. So that's so you have to understand that that's the caveat. So any of the graphs or charts that you see, please don't take them as a forecast of what we think prices would be in the future. They are what we think prices would be if you didn't do any more energy efficiency. And of course, we think it is a good idea to do more energy efficiency, so this is not an exact representation of what those prices would be. And this study gets done every 2 years. Why every 2 years? I think it's just, it takes us a number of months to do the project, and there's a certain cost involved. So it's a balance between having relevant data that's timely and the cost of doing stuff. No questions yet, so I'll keep going. Okay, there are a number of components of avoided costs of electricity. I've listed them all here. You've got them on your slide. I don't need to read them. The first one is energy, and that's the easiest one to understand. I don't spend any more time in this presentation to describe it to you because it's easy. if you install a compact fluorescent light bulb in your house, you take out an incandescent, put in a compact fluorescent, and you use it for a certain number of hours a day, that's 18, 19, 20 cents per kilowatt hour that you're not purchasing from the electric grid. That's what the energy portion is. So it accrues directly to whoever that homeowner, business owner, or project owner is. So that one's pretty easy to conceptualize, right? It's the same as if you just turned the light off and never turned it on again. How much energy are you saving? So we don't spend a lot of time on that one.
No, yeah, but it also includes, from what I read, installation of like solar voltaics, anything that is not connected to the grid,
yep,
or using less than what you would normally get from the grid. So it's two components, what you would use less because of energy efficiency and additional capacity from renewables. Is that correct?
Yeah, let me state it a different way and make sure we're saying the same thing. If this portion of it that I've labeled energy, if I install a solar panel at my facility or on my roof,
right,
and it produces, say, 500 kilowatt hours in a month,
yeah,
that's about how many kilowatt hours I use in my house for a whole month.
Yeah, right.
I'm not buying those 500 kilowatt hours.
Got your house. Very good. Thank you.
Yep.
Same.
My solar panel is producing it, so I don't need to buy it off the grid. Good. The rest of them there are more complicated. So I just state them here, but we're going to spend time talking about each one of them. Okay. So here's I'm going to give you the bottom line right off the bat, and then we'll show this slide again later on. If we assume, which number did we pick? We chose the 16.5 megawatt scenario. If you assume that's on the Cape and Vineyard, there were a couple of projects that altogether totaled 16.5 megawatts. So total amount of output, bright sunny afternoon like this, all the panels are in full sunlight. They measure a total of 16.5 megawatts. Over the course of the 20-year life of those projects, this is a total amount of money that we think accrues to savings, avoided costs, to all ratepayers. So notice that I included not energy here, but the other components, price, capacity, and infrastructure. We also did not include in here external CO2 costs. That's another topic that we can talk about as we get into this a bit later. We think it's an important one. It's in the study. We have a value for it, but I didn't want to include it on this chart just yet. So I just put a note there, but we can talk about that if people are interested. But not yet. Okay, so here's big picture. Let's get into the details.
Doug, before you get
ahead,
are you going to go back to the difference and for the board explain the definition of infrastructure, capacity, price impact as you go along?
Yes.
Okay.
Absolutely. So a picture of New England with a couple of data points. This comes from the system operator. They're located in Holyoke, Massachusetts. They run the electric grid every single day for all of us. They produce this slide. I think it's just a nice piece of background slide. I like to have it in here because if people ask me questions, I can quickly flip to a map of the region and it helps. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time. We all know what our six states look like. So the first one I'm going to go into is the price impact piece. It takes a little time to explain this price impact piece. So we're going to talk a little bit about how the electric grid works every day in order to explain that piece. So if you were to take a graph of the total amount of electricity used on June the 9th in 2008, I picked a random summer day a couple of years in the past. This is exactly how many megawatts we were using, all six states, in each hour. And you can see the classic summer load kind of day, right? We all wake up in the morning, we turn on clock radios and coffee makers and toaster ovens and all that stuff. And then on a summer day, we start to turn on our air conditioners to keep our homes and businesses cool. That usually peaks at around 4 o'clock in the afternoon and then starts to drop off as the temperatures cool off and our air conditioners don't have to work so hard. So the load starts to drop off and off and off and off until there's a leveling point there. And this is the first piece of audience participation. Any idea why on a summer afternoon the load levels off? It stops dropping for about 2 hours, right at about 8 o'clock in the middle of June.
Thermal inertia
is what's, I would say that's why the load is dropping in the first place, because our air conditioners are not working quite as hard. So I would expect, if it were just thermal inertia, for this to be a smooth drop off. And it is for a few hours, and then all of a sudden there, at what time is that? 7:30, 8 o'clock in June. It flattens.
That's when the TVs come on.
They finish dinner and wash.
Televisions is a good guess. Dinners is a good guess. I think that's part of it, but it's not the primary part.
Telemarketers.
Guess I haven't heard that guess before. Thank you.
Some things like refrigerators are always using electricity.
Refrigerators are always kind of kicking on and kicking off. A little bit more in the summer because it's generally warmer, but it's not.
Well, hopefully everybody by now has an energy efficient refrigerator and it's not making a significant contribution.
I like that answer too.
Is that your demand curve?
This is the demand curve.
Okay, it's a 24-hour cycle, right?
It's a 24-hour cycle.
And we all know that in a winter peaking company, between 4 o'clock in the afternoon and 8 o'clock at night is when you have system demand in the wintertime.
Yep.
And so
next jar.
That's the next jar. That's right.
All right, so during the summertime, as far as a fall off, is that when you have the so-called radiational cooling? That you know that occurs, so your demand goes off.
It's a good try. You're all thinking way too hard. You're thinking way too hard. I heard it.
Lights.
That's the effect of
same old stuff.
Yeah, that's the effect of what did the other slide say? 14 million people turning on light bulbs all at once. That's dusk. That's sunset right there. So to me, it's just kind of a fascinating thing that if you measure this for all of New England at once. You can see this effect very clearly. Loads dropping off as it's cooling off, and then all of a sudden, all at once, everybody turned the lights on. And so you get this flat portion where the load stops dropping for a while, and then around 9, 10 o'clock, we all start to go to bed, so all the lights come off, and the load drops way off. So I think that's a fun little tidbit to note, so I'll share it with you.
Commercial establishments are also dropping off there about that 8 or 9 o'clock at night.
Commercial establishments with the exclusion of, I would say, probably hotels that are trying to run those function rooms.
Shopping center, that kind of.
Yeah, I agree. One of the key points to notice here, that the amount of supply, the generation that's producing power, has to equal the amount of demand very precisely every single second, second to second to second. So if you think about how much energy are we consuming and how much is being produced, effectively they're equal every single second. And that's the job of the system operator in Holyoke, is to make sure that that's the case, that they're producing the exact amount of energy we need.
I'm just curious, for the mix that we have in Massachusetts, we have a little bit of hydroelectric, okay?
Yeah.
And in the summer, when that is going up, how much of that do they turn on to try and levelize this thing and make it work, or is this all done with conventional fossil and nuclear plants?
It's done with all of those, and the way the system operator actually figures out how much you're going to pay in every few minutes is they literally stack up all of those generation owners.
Okay.
And I'm going to get to that slide in, I think, two slots.
All right.
Maybe three. If I haven't answered your question there, ask it again.
Fine.
You didn't mention ISO. Is that ISO New England you're talking about?
Yes. When I say the system operator, I was trying to avoid the acronyms on you.
Okay.
So that's the ISO, the independent system operator. So if I inadvertently slip and say the ISO, that's who I'm talking about. That's the folks in Holyoke. So just for curiosity, here's the winter shape. If you look at the axes, in the summertime, overnight, low of 14,000, high of 26,000. Our all-time peak was about 28,000 on July 22nd of this year, Friday afternoon. In the wintertime, obviously peak loads are much lower because we don't have any cooling. We have a little bit of electric heating in New England, not a lot, a little bit. And you can see kind of a double peak. There's one in the morning, and then there's another one in the afternoon when, as a couple of folks said, we all come home in the evening. Notice the lighting effect is sort of swamped right in there because it gets dark at 4:30. So you can't really quite see the lighting effect in the wintertime. It's built right into this ramp up in the afternoon when we all get home and turn on the stove and turn on the news and everything else that we do.
Could we conclude that this is part of the reason why most of the maintenance work would be done in the winter and not in the summer?
Believe it or not, I didn't put up a slide of what it looks like in the fall and in the spring.
Yeah.
But that's when we do the maintenance work on our generation facilities.
Is it closer to the winter than the summer, though?
It's actually lower than the winter.
Oh, it's actually lower than the winter.
Yeah.
That would make sense, then, if that's when they take the plants down for maintenance. Okay.
Precisely correct. And they actually schedule them all. They can't just take maintenance whenever they want. A year or maybe, I think it's 18 months in advance. They have to submit when they want to do maintenance, and the system operator centrally schedules all of them to make sure we don't have too many off at once.
So it is ISO that actually schedules the maintenance of the plants for them to be able to keep the load in balance throughout the year?
Yeah, I'd say the ISO approves it. Okay. They kind of, they work with the generation owner. I mean, if you request March, they don't just automatically tell you, no, you do it in April.
Okay.
They work with you, but they do schedule to make sure that they don't all take off in the same week in April.
There's a certain part of the maintenance that goes on in a generating plant that does require mild weather and also to avoid severe weather as far as, you know, getting access to the kind of machines and equipment you need to get on board. It can materially affect, you know, any kind of, let's say corrosion analysis or preparation if you're doing coating and things like that. So springtime is very important for that.
Can I ask the three folks right in front of me? I don't want to ignore you, but you guys can't quite see me, so don't. I'll see your hand if you raise it.
Okay.
I'm still here behind you. You can hear me. So how do we figure out which units we want, which generation units we want to actually be running in every single hour, and how we set the price that we pay for electricity in every single hour? That's what this chart is about. What happens is, a day ahead of time, so today by noon, every owner of generation plants in New England has to submit to the system operator, I'm willing to produce power tomorrow, here's how many megawatts I'm willing to produce, and here's the price for it. And what the ISO does, sorry, the system operator does, is they stack up all those offers in increasing order, and it looks like this. This is the actual supply stack for July 20th of 2010. On a four-month time lag, we can get the actual data. And I don't know which one is which, so I can't tell you which one is, you know, the canal unit or some other one, but I do know all the numbers here. And what they actually, you can almost imagine a dot that slides from left to right and then back to left as we go through that summer day. Right in the morning, when the load is low, right, we're down around 14,000 megawatts, and you can see the price is somewhere less than $100, and then it literally just slides to the right as the load gets higher in the middle of the day, and then as the load starts to drop off, it slides back to the left. So the important point to notice here is that if the demand is 26,000 megawatts, right, there's some generation unit that bid in at $175, and we're telling them, we want you to run and produce power for that 1 hour in the middle of the afternoon. That's it. That's the only hour we need you in. We only need you in that 1 hour. You're more expensive than everybody else, so I don't want you to run in the morning. I don't need you then. But during that hour, everybody gets paid $175 a megawatt. That's the way we run the market. It's a single clearing price market, and we often refer to that as the marginal price in that hour is $175 a megawatt hour.
Now,
two questions. Yeah, go
okay,
ahead.
Okay, that would imply that if they're going to generate that electricity during that hour, they have to keep their larger plants on what's called spinning reserve at a lower thing, and then they're notified the day before that I've got to produce power from 1 to 2. On Martha's Vineyard, I'm just curious how this plays in. On Martha's Vineyard, we have 5 gas turbines, all right? And those gas turbines come in when the free wires coming over don't supply enough. How would that factor into something like this?
Excellent question. This is, of course, a very simple version of what actually has to go on every single day. It varies quite a bit by the type of the plant and how old it is and whatnot. Some plants can remain in an offline state, potentially for months, right? All maybe 8, 9, 10 months of the year. And then for 2 months in the summer, July and August, they know they might need me. And they can start up and get running within 30 minutes. We label them quick start for obvious reasons.
Okay,
but
very good.
There are certain plants that know they can start up within 30 minutes. There are others that we purposely have to, what's the term they use? Position, but there's another term they use for posture. That's the word I'm looking for. They sometimes have to posture plants a day ahead of time where they say, we need you to run tomorrow in those 2 hours in the middle of the day, but it takes you 10 hours to start your unit and get running. So you're going to turn on and start running at 6 in the morning, even though I don't need you until the middle of the afternoon.
Gotcha.
So it all depends on the type of plant, and obviously they do whatever they can to make the total cost of all those units running as low as possible.
Is there any... You had a question there.
Plants that are run for purposes of reliability or power quality, are they part of the scheme, or is that something separate?
They do that after they do this. So to get to the slightly more complicated version, where's my map? I knew I would get there. So for example, the two primary areas where we have to do this are in Southwest Connecticut near New York City, Stamford, Fairfield, Norwalk, all that area, and in and around Boston. But some of you may be aware that until recently, there was a lot of trouble with this in the on the Cape and the Vineyard in all of southeastern Massachusetts. The ISO, the system operator, takes this chart and they say, okay, we want all of you units to run in each hour. Everybody literally gets a schedule. Tomorrow I want you to run, you're a low-cost nuclear unit, you're going to run 24/7 for the next 18 months until you need to refuel. Mm-hmm. We know that. If you're a slightly higher cost natural gas unit, for example, we may only need you for a couple of hours. So they do this, they clear the energy market day ahead, and then they sit back and they look and they say, okay, which units actually cleared and where are they located? And if they happen to notice that the load in a particular area is going to be high enough, and those transmission wires are full of power already and they still don't have enough power, they may call a unit a day ahead of time and say, your price was $200, so you didn't clear in this market, but we know we need you to run for reliability reasons, not for price reasons. So we're going to pay you to run at your price of $200 for those couple of hours.
Does that set the market also?
No.
It doesn't.
It does not set the market clearing price. Unit gets $200, but they're the only one that gets $200.
At this point, you differentiate between the so-called peak coincident units versus the units that are making up a supplement in order to maintain the balance in your system.
Nope. Everybody gets paid, in this example, $175 per megawatt hour in that hour. And then a couple hours later, right, these top few units are now offline. They're not getting paid anything because they're not producing any energy. And everybody's getting paid $86. I just picked a couple of random numbers. Yeah.
This graph indicates that all of the units are reacting to that curve. But does not ISO have what would be referred to as base-loaded plants, like nuclears and coal, that on a regular basis, they say, you will, because you are reliable, you will be going 24/7 for long periods of time? And isn't it just the additional, I'll call it peaking units, like gas and whatever other type units that are in there that factor into this other? And on a regular basis, what is the base load and what is the load that they fool around with?
Yep. Excellent question. There's one slide I now wish I put in here, but I'll do my best. You'll notice on this chart that even in the wintertime, our lowest load, it doesn't go to zero on the y-axis. The lowest load, even in the wintertime, is around 12,000 megawatts.
Okay.
If I extended this down to zero, you've got 12,000 megawatts. They're just running all the time.
Okay, and that would be what they refer to as the base load, and the
yep.
rest of it is what's... So, okay, that's what I was trying to get a feel for. So about a third of it is base load, and about two-thirds, in the summer, two-thirds of it is what they use for peaking, and it looks like in the winter about double the capacity. Okay.
And the way we generally split it into three chunks. There's base load, which you assume is just running all the time, 24/7, until they have to go out for a few weeks for maintenance or
right.
fuel outage or whatever.
Fuel plants.
They never ramp up, they never ramp down, they turn on at their full amount, and they just put power, like Pilgrim, for example, turns on and it just runs all the time.
Right.
There's a separate set that we call intermediate or load following that will often ramp up and down a little bit throughout the day, depending on the day of the week and a number of other factors. And then there's a third set of peaking units that just don't run at all for probably 10 months of the year.
So the coal would probably be in that middle one because they can crush more coal and add more fuel, whereas the peaking ones are the ones that you have to start off right away.
Yeah. Coal actually has become a really interesting thing. That used to be the wisdom for probably decades, that coal was pretty much just a baseload unit. It turned on, Brayton Point turned on and just ran all the time.
So what's changed?
What's changed is the price of coal.
It's getting more expensive.
It is now the case that I don't think this is true of Brayton Point because of some of the upgrades and the age of the plant and whatnot. It's a little bit more efficient than some of the other ones. But some of the ones up in New Hampshire, for example, the two Schiller units right outside Portsmouth and the, not Newington, Merrimack unit a little bit further north, they all run on coal and they're much older. So they don't produce energy as efficiently. So their cost to produce energy is actually in many hours higher than it is for a natural gas plant. which has really turned things on its head in New England. Because it used to be the case that you could just stack it all up. Nuclear, the hydro coming down from Quebec and renewables, then the coal, then the oil, then the natural gas.
Okay.
Then the oil and natural gas flipped on us. The price of the two flipped on us, and that's why Canal doesn't run anywhere near as often as it used to, because it's now out of the money in most of the time.
Because
and now, coal has started to flip on us a little bit, which has become really interesting.
Is that because of the fracking and the gas that's coming out? Because gas now is like $3.70.
Yeah, because that's one of the primary reasons, because natural gas is so much cheaper than it used to be.
I'm sorry.
Sorry, just going to ask that question. I'm going to ask Maggie maybe to give me the...
You're okay. Nobody's falling asleep or nodding off.
That's good. Okay. So we were on this one. This is one of the key things to understand and keep in mind. That everybody is getting with a single clearing price market. Everybody gets paid this $175 per megawatt hour in that hour. So it's really important to us. Think about $175 per megawatt hour for an hour times... What are we at? 26,000 megawatts. That's a lot of money in that 1 hour. So if we can nudge that price down a little bit, we all save a lot of money. And that's the key behind the whole idea of price impact. So what sets that price for us in New England is the price of natural gas. In this slide, all this does is it says the ISO New England, the system operator, did a study a couple years ago that says what would happen on our system if we went out and built 10,000 megawatts of X, where X is either the Q, which is sort of our standard mix of oil and gas and other things, energy efficiency and demand response, what if we did that many megawatts, what if we did nuclear, what if we did integrated gas combined cycles, what if we did all these different scenarios, which fuel would set the price in how many hours? And the answer, as you can see, natural gas sets the price in almost every hour, no matter what we do to our system at any time in the near future. So there's nothing we can do in the near future to change the fact that natural gas is going to set the price in 90%+ of the hours.
Relative to the other fuels, what's natural gas in terms of 20%, 30% for New England?
You mean on price or total megawatts?
No, quantity. If it's setting the price, you've got nuclear, coal, oil, and gas.
Yep.
And if gas is setting the price, what part of that is related to gas, so that if the price of gas goes up, what's that going to do to the, and how drastic would it be for the increase in the price of electricity?
Well, remember that everybody, no matter what fuel you're running on, what this slide tells me, it doesn't matter what fuel I'm running on, whether it's natural gas or something else. The amount of money I make is based on the price in the electricity market. The price of the electricity market is based on the price of natural gas.
Okay.
So there's roughly 10,000 megawatts of natural gas available to us. The other
in
20
New England?
In New England. The
out of
roughly
25?
Out of a total of around 37 right
Thank
now.
You.
35,
Thank
37.
You.
So it's a little less than a third.
Right.
A couple more questions here. Yeah.
You refer to, I'm talking about the natural gas thing. You refer mostly to New England.
Mm-hmm.
Can you relate that only to Barnstable County, Cape Cod?
I will say the answer is almost entirely the same. Because we're so interconnected with all of New England, it's not substantially different here than it is there.
Okay.
And I know I can say that because the same question came to me from the legislators in Vermont a couple years ago, and I gave them the same answer. You're connected to all of New England, so your price is pretty much the New England price for the most part. That's not entirely true, but for the most part, that's true.
It's not true.
So it's really the price of natural gas that's going to determine the energy price.
That's going to determine the energy price. That's correct. In roughly 90% of the hours of the year.
And if you remember back before they had hydrofracking and Marcellus Shale, remember where we were with natural gas prices relative to our electricity prices in, 2006, 2007, 2008?
The end of 2005 when Hurricane Katrina hit. Natural gas went to $14,
right.
Electricity prices were 13, 14 cents, and then it occurred again in mid-2008 when oil went up to $147 a barrel and natural gas was kind of connected with it price-wise, but now there's a total disconnect. There's no relationship anymore between the two. Natural gas is running its own pricing. It's not correlated anymore with the other fuels.
Excellent. Transition, thank you. I just went to the next slide number 12. shows our forecast of natural gas prices out into the future. All the detail behind why we believe this is true is in the full report itself. You're welcome to read it. It's on our website. I've provided you a web link for that on the bottom. And I think Maggie probably distributed it to you,
you
or some of it.
You have the memo and a cover memo. You have the link to the website for the full report.
But it's here.
But someone mentioned shale gas. Yes, that is a big reason why we believe that the price of natural gas will remain relatively low over the next 30 years.
Yeah, I wonder, since we are recording, I think this would be a good time to mention for the folks that are watching what that web link is. And I believe that you can access it through synapse-energy.com, and there's a whole bunch of links that I won't go through that, but www.synapse-energy.com. And if you go there, there'll be a way of sort of getting through your webpage in order to get all of the information that you're talking about here.
Yes, that's a good point. It's freely available. You can download it. If you go there and look for the link that says publications, and then you look up AESC, Avoided Energy Supply Costs, you'll find it pretty easily. Okay. And if you note the shape of this graph, and I go one slide forward to the price of electricity, you will see that the shape looks identical for all the reasons we just discussed. And the one extra line there that you see in the brown, yellow, I'm not sure what color it is, orange on your
mustard.
On your chart, mustard color, thank you. I was going to say burnt orange, or is the value that we had predicted 2 years ago in 2009. And you can see how much it's dropped, primarily because of the shale gas.
I guess at some point in time, I'd like to have you just explain why, with all of the difficulties that are coming on, especially with Marcellus Shale, especially with states like New York that are saying, no, you can't do it, with the fact that I just read recently where in Maryland they just passed new rules with regard to fracking that are going to make the gas companies clean up the water. I mean, the industry is totally against it, and it implies, at least to me, that when I see a forecast so low for natural gas, that it might seem unrealistic. So what you're doing is you're basically taking what the industry is saying and projecting it out. Is that correct?
I'm not taking what the natural gas industry is saying. We want to make that clear.
All right. What are you taking?
We base this on two different pieces. If you go back one slide, you can see there that we, in the green line there, we've got actual futures. So that people have traded on NYMEX. People have actually gone out and put money down.
Futures trading, I got you.
Futures trading out to a certain point where we believe that the volume of that futures trading is too thin to be reliable. From there on out, we use the Energy Information Administration's annual energy outlook from there on out. Within the study group, and I saw all of the different, I showed on the one slide, all the different people that are involved in the study group, there was a lot of debate about whether the price of natural gas really should be forecasted to be this low into the future.
You're right.
And there are a lot, there are very many quite valid environmental concerns that are likely to cause extra costs. What we had to do as the folks writing this study is look at the data that we have available and the concerns we have over environmental costs, for which we couldn't find anyone who was willing to project, here's the amount of money that will, here's the amount in dollars that will change the price of natural gas. So we're in this place where we have a number of people within our own study group explaining to us, we think it should be higher, we think it should be higher. And we said, oh, I completely understand your reasoning why. Show me something that says I should move this price by 10 cents or 50 cents or a dollar. There's nothing out there available. So in 2 years, if we get the chance to do it again, I hope there's more information out there about what that price impact might be.
Peter, we do need to get through the whole presentation. Perhaps you could say that until the end.
I'm happy to hang around and talk more afterwards.
A brief question. On slide 13, there's a graph that forecasts electricity prices. Now, it appears implicit in this graph that you believe that going out through 2030, that natural gas will remain the fuel that's on the margin in the ISO. Is that correct?
Yes.
And do we currently have the capacity to get there? And if not, is there an implicit assumption here that either plants will switch fuel because it's economically advantageous, or there will be plants added that use this fuel.
The implicit assumption is that no matter what we add in the future, natural gas will still set the clearing price. So we do believe that there will be retirements, primarily of older coal and oil units in the near future. We do believe that there will be additions of new power plants. I don't want to say primarily, but one of the key factors is additions to meet RPS requirements. So there will be new renewable projects coming online to meet RPS requirements throughout the region. And then we also believe there will be some additions. We weren't able to specify exactly where and which ones. If those new additions come in at a price lower than natural gas is still setting the clearing price in every hour of the day. And it's likely that the ones that come on are probably going to be natural gas units, brand new, more efficient, so they'll be a little bit lower cost on the scale of natural gas units. So, all right, we've been asked to hurry up a little bit, so I'll try and do that. So, these last few slides, that explains the chunk of price impact. If we can move that price by using a little bit less energy in any 1 hour, then we're saving, and everybody saves lots of money. If I individually have a 10,000 megawatt load and I can reduce that by 1,000 megawatts, everybody benefits because everybody pays less for their electricity.
Using it through energy efficiency or renewable energy, self-distributed generation.
Yep, through any of those means. So these few slides are all to explain price impact. That's the hardest one to understand. Now I can go into the other ones, which are a little bit easier to understand. This is the next hardest one to understand is capacity cost. When we pay for electricity, you don't see this on your bill anyway. There's no line item on your bill. I double-checked on mine last night just to be sure. It says capacity costs, despite the fact that I spend most of my time working on this. There's no line item on there for it. We pay electricity generators in New England for the energy output they give us in any individual hour. We also pay them a monthly payment just to be ready to run. And that's called their capacity cost, for their capacity to produce energy. And it's primarily geared towards how much can you produce on a hot summer day. But that's what they get paid for. As a matter of fact, we have taken the Cape Light Compact's energy efficiency programs. We've demonstrated how much savings they're actually producing on a hot summer afternoon. And we submit that to the system operator. And we've cleared in that market. And we're getting paid the same price that any generation unit is being paid for those number of kilowatts. We're up to 11, 12 megawatts right now. So we receive monthly capacity payment. So energy efficiency can get this payment. Behind the meter generation can get this payment. Generators get this payment. So to the extent that any energy efficiency amount or behind the meter generation can reduce the total need for capacity or reduce that price, everybody saves on their capacity cost.
Does this justify why many utilities insist on a standby charge?
Completely different thing. Okay. Sorry, yeah, very, very different thing than this. Yeah, that's more to do with infrastructure. And I'll get to infrastructure in a minute. Okay, I'll keep going. Capacity. Infrastructure, there we go. So, this is the cost of maintaining all the poles and wires and all the substations and everything else I'm used to calling them transmission owners, but they're the distribution utilities, NSTAR in this territory. This is the cost that they need to maintain all the poles and wires and substations and everything else. Just to make it very clear, this is not the amount that we use in the study, the amount that we use in the memo, is not a value that we calculated. It's a value that NSTAR gave to us. They said, here's how much it costs us to maintain those poles and wires. So we don't go and calculate that ourselves. That's something that each individual distribution utility gives to us during the course of this study. And that's the value that we use. It's this, what they want the standby charge, primarily because they have to provide you with a wire and services big enough so that if your distributed generator is not running, they still want it. They still want to collect the total amount of money they think that you should be paying them. I'm happy to get more into that one later. It's kind of off topic a little bit. But
there was a time when utility companies were proposing to use gas for air conditioning, for example, and other things. but they still want the electric standby in case it failed, and that standby charge was justified.
Yep. Yep. But it can be a large number. So.
That's true. Yeah.
But how much of the how much of the infrastructure cost on percentage basis of the total bill, roughly?
Of the total bill, like at your home?
Yeah.
Okay, we just did this calculation last night, and I double-checked with Joe. Thank you, Joe. It's about 1.5 cents, 1.6 cents.
It's not big.
So, it's not big. The only other piece I wanted to mention on infrastructure, I saw this presentation.
Sorry, just one comment.
Yeah, please.
Fred, the transmission costs have gone up over the last few years because of a lot of the projects that are being put in now by the distribution companies. Yeah. And I've heard over the next 5+ years that transmission costs will probably go, they've doubled, I think, in the last few years, and I think they're projected to double again. And I don't know, Doug, if you want to comment on that.
I promise I'm not paying Joe to be my straight man, but this is twice now he's done this, and I thank him for it. You heard my comment that the number we actually used when we calculated the avoided cost from infrastructure was given to us by, in this case, NSTAR. At a meeting this summer, I sat through a presentation given to a group of us by all of the distribution companies throughout all of New England, and they said two things. I combined two presentations together. They said, here's how much we have been charging you for transmission over the past 15 years, 16 years, and here's how much we expect to charge you over the next few years. So you can see it's a big rise. There are a number of caveats they made me swear in blood that I would put on the bottom of this slide before I showed it to anyone. So there are a number of caveats there. These are just forecasts of potential future costs. They might be lower. They might also be higher. Their primary argument is that we have underinvested in transmission in New England for the past 10 or 15 years, and now it's time to catch up.
And don't expect it to go down.
I might have asked them for better timing, personally, but that's the argument they're using for us. So I wanted to let folks know that 1.6 cents now, will that rise to 3 cents in the next few years? Potentially so, but I can't say that for sure.
Yeah. Is transmission fully unbundled now, or is it still being provided by the distribution companies?
I'm not sure I get your question.
Well, back in the 90s, when the idea was that we'd separate the value chain into three distinct parts, the idea was the transmission would be provided by transmission companies, generation by generation
yep.
companies, distribution by distribution companies. Has that vision come to pass, or?
The way I understand it is that it's broken into two pieces, the generation by generation companies, the transmission and distribution.
Only two, Ron, sorry, Brad. We don't have a three. It's all in Massachusetts. So the 97 Restructuring Act created T&D companies, transmission and distribution companies, and then generation, not three.
For a real physical example, NSTAR owns the wires. Well, I don't see any at the moment. There they are. The wires right out here, which would be considered distribution. But if you happen to be flying over Pilgrim and you see a wide swath of trees cleared out for the big, huge power lines coming out of Pilgrim to deliver to the rest of the region, they also own those high-voltage transmission lines. The key here on infrastructure is that they build infrastructure for the peak day. They have to build enough wires and poles and substations and equipment and everything else to deliver the most amount of electricity you're going to need over a year. So there's only an hour or two during the year where they're really loading it up completely, but that's the number they have to build it for. So anything that I were to do to reduce my load on a hot summer day saves everybody a little bit of money on infrastructure. Whether I'm reducing load from conservation or if I'm distributing power from a solar panel on my own roof, it doesn't need to go across their system. It just comes right through the wire that I paid to have installed on my house. And so there's that much power that doesn't have to come across the wires, saves us a little bit of money on infrastructure. That's it, folks.
Okay.
That's everything.
Before I open up to questions, I want to point out that there's always a reason to be having these presentations. And in this case, Maggie and I had talked about how important it was to quantify for all of us in a document that the Cape Light Compact ratepayer funds provided to CBEC will bring benefits to both the member towns and all the ratepayers. So part of this is to give you some background as to how some of these benefits are identified and how we provide an analysis. Now, having said that, Peggy, do you have anything to add to that?
I just want to, and I think this slide is important, because the 16.5 megawatts that Doug addressed is the CVDC round one of our proposed PV installation that is right now in the permitting stages. So what this slide is demonstrating, and then it's been backed up by the avoided energy supply cost and the data that goes behind that, is this, that project, round one of our PV installation from the Cape and Vineyard Electric Cooperative that was supported, funded by CLC with ratepayer funds, brings a benefit to two entities, so to speak. One, the host, obviously if the town is hosting the PV panel, they will be benefiting from reduced electricity savings. Internally then flowing that in theory back down to distributing it to taxpayers, so your town is benefiting. And then secondly, and most even more significantly, is you can quantify your return on rate investment of ratepayer funds to a, I think it's a $48 million over the life of the project. So your $2-point-something million CLC ratepayer funds to date have, will, shall return, assuming these projects permitted construction online, over the 20 years will return $40 million to all ratepayers, regardless of where they participate in the Cape Light Compact's power supply program, energy efficiency program on the Cape and Vineyard over the life of the project. And I don't remember, what is it annually? It was in your memo, actually. I think we said annually the benefit is...
I think it's a little less than $2
million
in the memo. Because, let's see. Save rate pay is $40 million in avoided cost over a 20-year term of the contract.
Yep. Like $1.8 million, I think, a year?
Yeah. We actually did a calculation of the annual avoided cost as well.
Okay. So again, that, and I think that that message is really important to understand, why are we pursuing renewable energy projects? Specifically, why are we pursuing round one and round two of PV projects on the Cape and Vineyard? Because they bring tangible, quantifiable benefits to all ratepayers.
Not the least of which is the, our contribution to the reduction of what I call significant carbon intrusion into, you know, into our environment. And I think that, you know, that when we first started with the risk assessment of why Cape Light Compact was interested in looking at this, it was all part of our motivation. And it's good to see that we have some quantifiable evidence that we're making progress in that. This one, sorry. Yeah.
In due deference to the clock, if there's a fast way to explain this, I think it would be very helpful for me to understand. I think most of the presentation focuses on justifying the assumptions behind the stack bar graph on slide six. And I think you do a very credible job doing that. What I don't understand is how you get from those assumptions to the calculation that yields this graph.
Okay. How do I go from here's how we set the marginal price and blah, blah, to a number?
Right.
I'm going to show you one very complicated graph, which I, that's the short answer, is when we come out with, you see in the very right, we end up with all-in electricity prices. But you can see we take into account a whole bunch of different things, including emission prices, expected loads in the near future, near-term capacity addition, so new generation, whether it be renewable or otherwise, that gets built, prices of fuel, both of natural gas and oil and others, the configuration of the transmission system and any known near-term changes to that, renewable portfolio standard requirements. We add in all these different pieces. We have a separate company that focuses more on renewables additions that they help us out with this study. We have a separate gentleman that helps us with the gas price forecasts. All this together goes into, you'll see in the very center of the slide, a modeling product called Market Analytics. We do a production cost model where we actually simulate the actual turning on and turning off of every power plant in New England every hour of the year for the next 20 years. And all of that together we pull in, including what we think the price for renewable energy credits will be and any offset to that. So all the RPS goals are a percentage of sales. So if you actually reduce the total number of kilowatt hours that you're using in a year, you have to buy a little bit less on your renewable energy credits, a little bit fewer of those. So we factor that in as well.
Fred, is that the response to your question?
Enough. Not really, but I'm not sure we have time to fully...
Okay. I encourage you to skim through the study. It's got a lot more detail.
Okay.
If you look at the federal government's website on energy, it lists monthly all of the rates of all of the states, okay? So you can rate them high to low, okay? Then from my electric bill, I get my rates that I pay. And the only state that's higher than what we pay on the Cape is Hawaii. So we have the highest rates in the continental United States here on Cape Cod. Is there some reason for that?
I'm not sure that's a question that I have.
Because of the character of the plants that are serving us, the aging infrastructure, the characteristics of the distribution system, and the and issues with regard to transmission. All of those add up just as far as...
It isn't that Star wants to give us the business because of the Cape Light Compact?
The cost would be high whether there was a Cape Light Compact or not.
Okay.
Yes. I would think also that that would lend to the fact that, or the opportunity that with every step to renewables, if we're enjoying the highest rate, we would see that the greatest savings.
Well, yes. Yes. And indeed, one of the things that comes up from time to time, let's say economic philosophers of the modern stripe, like Friedman and places like that, he suggests that if there's an incentive for the development of renewables, it has a connection to the high cost of energy as it stands. And the contribution of high cost of energy is the cost of the fuels. I worked for Boston Edison at a time when we actually gave a rebate on the fuel cost, the fuel adjustment charge. So remember those halcyon days.
I just have one other quick question. In your write-up, you don't include in your avoided cost any cost of carbon, okay? And you also state in there that in order to keep carbon at 450 parts per million, it would be $80 a ton. And the United States is one of the only countries, well, I shouldn't say the only country, the United States does not have a carbon cost. Australia just put one in and other countries are thinking of it. If there was a price of carbon included, have you figured out what the additional avoided cost would be and how valuable that cost of carbon is, and if so, what is it?
Yeah, just to be clear, we had included what we call the already internalized cost of carbon, because we all have, we're under REGI. So we have a REGI cost we have to pay. Right. That's included in the energy portion already. Okay. The external cost is exactly what you're talking about. Right. We believe that at some point in the near future, there will be a price of carbon.
Okay, I agree.
And we believe that once that cost is kind of put on the plate, whether that's a federal regulation or whatever, we think that number over a number of years is going to be $80 a ton. And if you take $80 a ton, it comes out to, I put it on the slide here for you, that's the external CO2 cost. So it's not an internalized cost now. We believe it will be and it should be, so we've called it an external cost. But we have predicted what we think it will be. The cost to abate that much carbon to get us down to 450 parts per million, we call it the marginal abatement cost. And we think that's going to be $80 a ton in our reference case. We do high and low as well.
Okay, Warren, you had a question, and after that, I think we'll play off yourself.
Okay, thank you very much for your presentation. The question I have is, what about on these parameters that you have, these different factors, which one includes the investment costs, relative investment costs, of, say, putting up a PV array versus a fossil fuel plant?
Great question. This does not address the cost of putting in those systems at all. This only shows the benefits. So somewhere else, someone can tell you, here's what the cost of doing those projects was or will be.
So the investment cost, the operation and maintenance, and this kind of thing, that's what I read.
Yeah.
And I was wondering if I missed something.
Yep, but nope. We did not estimate the cost of putting in that 16.5 megawatts in this case at all. We just did, we were asking just the benefits.
Well, with that, if there are no further questions from the board, I want to say how much I appreciate you coming in. And I also would hope that if there are further questions that are generated because people are going to the webpage, I see you were, you have the your website listed, and you have your name, so you're a target, right? So
yes.
Be available to you.
Yes, either directly to me or through Maggie, whichever is more comfortable for you. Feel free to shoot questions to us, and we'll do our best to get answers to them.
Well, thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank you, Doug.
You're welcome. My pleasure.